Welcome back, folks. My name is Lou, and it's time for us to get back into our regularly scheduled content. For the uninitiated, I'm working on a sci-fi first-person shooter roguelite. Last devlog, I started the process of rebuilding the project from scratch to get rid of some awful spaghetti code. This devlog is continuing the process of building back up to the point we were at before the reset, so let's get right back into it. The first task I wanted to tackle was to clean up our weapon code quite a bit. To do this, I had the idea of splitting our weapon up into a number of parts that could easily be swapped. Triggers and barrels and mags, oh my. Each module shares the same base class defining just that, what a weapon module is. From there, I get more specific. The first of these I made was the fire control group based on an idea I explained last time. This allows me to have different presets for fire modes, fire rates, and burst length for a given weapon. The second kind of module are magazines, defining how much ammo is in a weapon at once. The third kind of module is the barrel, which is the most complex one. In it, we define our damage, range, and base spread like we had previously. On top of that, we now have an integer called shots, which is how many projectiles will be fired at once, allowing me to turn any weapon into a shotgun. We also have damage falloff over a distance, as defined by a curve, and a few variables defining weapon heat and cooling, which deals with inaccuracy as a result of sustained firing. More on that in a bit. The last kind of module is our weapon optic, which defines our aiming reticle, if we can zoom in with a weapon, and if so, how many times, and if we can fire while zoomed. Again, more on that in a bit. With these new modules, I went back and fixed the shotgun once again. The only tweak I added was an option to single load bullets into a magazine. This looks pretty goofy if enabled on other weapons, but with the shotgun it works exactly as intended. The only thing I still need to add is an interrupt to this reload cycle, and it'll be fully finished. As mentioned, now any weapon can technically be a shotgun, so the only thing I still need to figure out is an alternative to the barrel module that allows for actual projectiles to be shot instead of hitscan. The last thing regarding weapon modules is I added a new scriptable object defining the stock configuration of a weapon. This way our instance of a weapon will automatically revert to using stock parts if there is nothing equipped in that slot. I also use this stock configuration as a reference to determine a weapon module's compatibility with a weapon. See, one thing I learned from the last version of the project is I don't want to have loads and loads of types that aren't cross-compatible. What I mean is I don't want to have to independently define and have separate types for SMG barrels, rifle barrels, SMG magazines, rifle magazines, and so on and so forth. Instead, each module contains a list of stock configurations. When setting a module, we check if the weapon we're trying to attach to's stock configuration is in that list. If so, we allow the assignment. And if not, we don't change the value and instead throw up a debug log saying, this module is not compatible with this weapon. This is baked right into our getter and setter, so at runtime, once we have a weapon modification station, it'll automatically run this check when we try to change attached weapon modules. But we don't have a weapon modification station yet. And even without it, I still want to run this same check when we assign the value in the inspector. The problem with this is there's no default way to use accessors in the Unity inspector. They just simply aren't shown. Using UI Toolkit, we can try to bind to the accessor by setting the name as our binding path in the custom inspector. And this does point to the correct variable, but it simply doesn't do anything. Instead, we can create a custom control for UI Toolkit, implement that into our custom inspector, and we're off to the races. After a day or so of research and fiddling with code, this is the result. I built this by reverse engineering Unity's example of binding custom controls. Essentially, all we're doing is creating a basic object field, and then running our check when we attempt to update the value of it. If the object is compatible, then we update the value, and if not, we log a warning. I considered trying to figure out how to make this work more generically, so I could use one control for any kind of weapon module. However, I remembered how finicky object fields were as is, and promptly decided to just take the easy way out. So each control is technically unique, but there are really only minor differences between them. So now that our technical UI Toolkit project is out of the way, on to the more visually appealing one. When I first redid the aiming in our previous version of the project, I had a static image in the center of our screen for a reticle. However, that took me straight back to 2001. It works, but it innately kind of feels bland. When trying to portray the concept of recoil to the player, there are quite a few ways to do it. One method is via a procedural recoil system, which is the first method I tinkered with when I was trying to much more realistically model the held weapon of the player. There are different takes on this kind of system, but the important thing to know is that it actually changes the point of aim of the player. Up, down, or side to side, depending on the specific weapon and game. A much simpler method is weapon bloom, or the expansion of your reticle with each shot. Because I didn't want to redo the old system, and because I didn't want to have a static reticle, I decided to go with the option I've not tried yet. This is where those new properties of the weapon barrels come in. Each weapon now contains a property called heat. This heat is gained at a rate equal to this value each time the weapon fires. Heat is also lost at a rate of this value times time.deltaTime each frame. You cool much faster using this other value if you stop firing. And if you reload, your heat value just gets set straight back to zero. Heat is also clamped between this value and this value. In the case of the AR barrel, it can never go below zero and never above 20. When we go to fire our next shot, we evaluate this curve using the heat value, and use the number it produces in our calculation for determining the direction our raycast will go in. The reason I'm using a curve here is because it allows me to do funky things like make weapons more accurate the longer you fire them. I also factor in the zoom level so we're more accurate when zoomed in. However, that's only half of the equation. The other half is having the HUD respond correctly. To take care of this, I whipped up a basic UI document for the heads-up display as a whole, containing a specific visual element where the reticle will be stored. Separately, I created the reticle. The reticle is made up of two layers, a static portion that will not move and an animated portion that will move. Both are essentially boxes that will contain other visual elements at specific anchor points. I can resize the box, but the other components stay stationary relative to their anchor. I would like to have the components expand into the shape of a circle instead of a square, but UI Toolkit seems to have issues with the idea for some reason. Either way, on the player I created a new script to act as a manager for the player's heads-up display. It's responsible for updating the reticle to match that of the held weapon's optic. The inventory controller then passes our calculated heat value into the HUD manager to visually show bloom to the player. The HUD manager will also keep track of ammo in our current weapon, our current held ammo, and display a silhouette and magnification when we zoom in. The last thing regarding weapons is the update to the view model. I largely scrapped the movement using a sine wave from last time. I still couldn't figure out what was causing the jittering, so I just went back to what I knew. I re-added the weapon sway as we originally had it in the previous version of the project. However, I added another function which takes place before the sway is actually applied. What this does is generate two vector threes based on a number of factors. One of these is the translation of the view model, or the up, down, forward, back, side to side movement, and the other is the Euler rotation to be applied, also known as the roll, pitch, and yaw. These values then get added directly to the others when we go to apply our sway and tilt sway. I'm pretty happy with the result. It's noticeable but not distracting, and looks significantly better than the handmade animations I used before. The only tweaks I still need to make to it are to move our variables off the view model script and onto some part of the weapon script, that way each weapon can move slightly differently. The last big task I got done was to re-add armor and stat buffs from that armor. Unlike last time, you can't directly modify the buffs on a piece of armor because I'm using a scriptable object, so modifying one would modify every instance of that piece of armor. However, it does add the stat buffs onto the player on startup correctly. The next big rework for the characters will probably revolve around refining that armor system. But the goal for this devlog is not to build that system out entirely, it was to catch back up to a point similar to where we were before, so this meets that requirement. The last thing I got done was to finish wiring up the behavior for crouching on the player. As mentioned last time, this was mostly done already, I just needed to resize the player's collider. This was a fairly simple copy and paste from the old version of the project. Though I did tweak a couple values because our player's collider is both slightly shorter and much narrower than our old one. There were also a couple tasks I didn't get finished, the most notable one being that I didn't add weapon audio back. The reason for this is that one of the recent Humble Bundles included a sound effects pack with something like 9,500 sounds, ranging from music to monster sounds to alarms to weapon sounds. I'm sorting through those first to see what I may want to use. When I do add weapon audio back, it'll be largely the same as before. Each weapon will have an array of sounds for each action, and when you do that action, one will get picked randomly from the array to be played. I also didn't add ammo replenishment because I like the idea of your maximum held ammo being affected by a stat on your armor. However, that brings up the question, where is the ammo value going to be stored? Right now it's a variable on the weapon, but this makes it harder to do that stat modification. However, if I were to move that value onto the player, what happens to the ammo when a weapon gets dropped and a different weapon gets picked up? We don't want to use that same value in the player, but we also don't want to just override it either because if somebody else picks up the weapon, it still needs to be available for use. So there's still a couple more things to determine on that front. Before I start closing out the video, I wanted to say thank you guys for all the love on the previous video about UltraKill. Since that video started popping off, the channel has more than doubled in size, which does mean a lot to me. I hope that all the new folks stick around and enjoy watching both the channel and my project grow. But it's not like I can rest on my laurels quite yet, so let's list our goals for next time. The big task is going to be creating new enemy AI. Last time I tinkered with AI, I used a state machine like on the player. However, that apparently has trouble with more complex behavior, so I'll be looking into using behavior trees instead. I'd also like to add sounds back to the weapon, as well as other sounds like footsteps, which are also in that big audio pack I mentioned before. One thing I actually need to implement is bullet hole decals, mostly so we can verify that our new reticle system is working properly. I know at very least the weapon heat does cause more inaccuracy the longer you fire, however, I'm not convinced that our reticle is getting properly sized to match it because it's kinda hard to tell with debug lines alone. Finally, I do need to sort out the ammo tracking situation like I mentioned before. Once again, I'd like to thank you guys for watching. Next week, I'll be continuing the trend of alternating between devlogs and other topics. More specifically, next week's topic will be about how a game I played as a kid helped me understand a core concept in one of my college classes as an adult. Subscribe to stay up to date both on this project as well as catch other videos as they come out. If you enjoyed, be sure to drop a like on the video, and I've been enjoying your all's comments from previous videos, so keep them rolling in. And with that, I'll catch you guys next time.